Welcome to Grab and Go Info. In this tutorial, we will talk about four clustering model algorithms, compare their results, and discuss how to choose a clustering algorithm for a project. You will learn what are the different types of clustering model algorithms, how to run K-means, Gaussian mixture model, hierarchical model, and DBSCAN model in Python, how to use PCA and t-SNE for dimensionality reduction and visualization, how to utilize clustering model results for the business, how to select a clustering model algorithm for your project. Let's get started. Based on the underlying algorithm for grouping the data, the clustering model can be divided into different types. The following four types are the most widely used types of clustering models. Centroid model uses the distance between a data point and the centroid of the cluster to group data. K-means clustering is an example of a centroid model. Distribution model segments data based on their probability of belonging to the same distribution. Gaussian mixture model is a popular distribution model. Connectivity model uses the closeness of the data points to decide the clusters. Hierarchical clustering model is a widely used connectivity model. Density model scans the data space and assigns clusters based on the density of data points. DBSCAN is a popular density model. In this tutorial, we will create clustering models for the same dataset using the four algorithms and compare their results. In the first step, we will import the Python libraries. Pandas and NumPy are for data processing. Matplotlib and Seaborn are for visualization. Datasets from the Sklearn library contain some toy datasets. We will use the Iris dataset to illustrate different ways of deciding the number of clusters. PCA and t-SNE are for dimensionality reduction. K-means, agglomerative clustering, Gaussian mixture, and DBSCAN are for clustering models. To get the code for this tutorial, please check out my blog post on medium.com. I will put the link in the video description. Medium.com is my most referenced website for data science and machine learning. It charges $5 per month for full access. I have been a medium.com member for many years, and that's the best $5 I spent every month. If you would like to support me as a content creator and buy me a cup of coffee, please use the link in the video description to join the Medium membership at no additional cost. If you prefer not to join, you can still read the post because there are a couple of free posts each month for everyone to read. Okay, let's continue. Step 2 reads the data. We first load the data using load iris, which is in a Python dictionary format. The keys of the dictionary show that the iris dataset includes the data, target, frame, target names, description of the dataset, feature names, file name, and data module. Next, let's print out the feature names, target names, and target. We can see that there are four features: sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. The target contains the names of three different flowers: Setosa, Versicolor, and Virginica, which are encoded into three numbers, 0, 1, and 2. In order to use the data for the clustering model, we need to convert the data into a data frame format. Using info, we can see that the dataset has 150 records and there are no missing values. Using value counts, we can see that there are 50 records for each type of flower. Clustering model is a type of unsupervised model, so we will not use the target information for the model. Only the four features will be utilized in the model, and the goal is to group the same type of flowers together. Therefore, a new data frame called X is created, which includes only the four features. After creating the modeling dataset and before running the model, we need to decide the number of clusters. Deciding the optimal number of clusters is a critical step in building a good unsupervised clustering model. In my previous tutorial, I talked about five ways for deciding number of clusters in a clustering model. It covered the elbow method, the silhouette score, the hierarchical graph, AIC, BIC, and gap statistics for deciding the number of clusters. In this tutorial, we will not repeat the content and will use 3 as the number of clusters directly. K-means clustering algorithm works as follows for a dataset with n data points and k clusters. Step 1, k data points are randomly selected as the centroids. In the Python Sklearn implementation, this step corresponds to a hyperparameter called init. The default value is k-means++, which is an improved version that makes the centroids to be far from one another. Step 2. Assign all the data points to the closest centroid, and we get k clusters. Step 3. Calculate the new centroid for each cluster based on the data points in the cluster. Step 4. Repeat step 2 and step 3 until the centroids do not change anymore. When using the Sklearn implementation of k-means, firstly, We need to initiate the model using the method kmeans and specify the number of clusters. The random state is for results reproducibility. Secondly, we fit and predict on the modeling data and save the prediction output in a variable called ykmeans. Next, the prediction results are saved in the data frame as a column. Finally, we check the counts for each cluster and see that there are 62, 50, and 38 data points in the three clusters respectively. Let's talk about the pros and cons of kmeans. Kmeans is fast and scalable, but the model performance is highly impacted by the initial centroids. Some centroids initiation can produce suboptimal results. Kmeans model does not perform well when the cluster sizes vary a lot, have different densities, or have a non-spherical shape. In step 5, we will talk about hierarchical clustering. Agglomerative clustering is a type of hierarchical clustering algorithm. It uses a bottom-up approach and starts each data point as an individual cluster. Then the clusters that are closest to each other are connected until all the clusters are connected into one. The hierarchical clustering algorithms produce a binary tree, where the root of the tree includes all the data points, and the leaves of the tree are the individual data points. The Python code implementation of the hierarchical clustering model is similar to the k-means clustering model. We just need to change the method from k-means to agglomerative clustering. The pros of hierarchical model include: hierarchical model works well for large datasets or a large number of clusters. It's flexible about the shape of the data. It can use any pairwise distance, such as Euclidean, Manhattan, and cosine distance. But the con of hierarchical model is that agglomerative clustering needs to use a connectivity matrix in order to scale to a large dataset. The connectivity matrix is computationally expensive when no connectivity constraints, because it considers all the possible combinations of merges. In step 6, we will talk about Gaussian mixture model. Gaussian mixture model is a probabilistic model that assumes each data point belongs to a Gaussian distribution. It uses the expectation maximization algorithm. In the expectation step, the algorithm estimates the probability of each data point belonging to each cluster. In the maximization step, each cluster is updated using the estimated probability of belonging to the cluster of all the data points. The updates of the cluster are mostly impacted by the data points with high probabilities of belonging to the cluster. The Python code implementation of Gaussian mixture model is similar to the k-means clustering model. We just need to change the method from k-means to Gaussian mixture. One difference is that we change the value for n-init from the default value of 1 to 5. N-init is the number of initialization to generate. When setting it to 5, it means that 5 initializations for the model will be performed, and the one with the best result is kept. Gaussian mixture model pros include: it's a generative model, so we can generate new data for the clusters based on the distributions. It's a probabilistic model, and works very well on ellipsoidal-shaped data. Gaussian mixture model cons include: may converge to a suboptimal solution because of the initial values, so we need to set n-init to run the model multiple times and pick the best initial values. It does not work well on the dataset that is not ellipsoidal shape. In step 7, we will talk about the DBSCAN model. DBSCAN defines clusters using data density. It has two important hyperparameters to tune: eps and min samples. Eps is the epsilon distance to be considered as the neighborhood of a data point. It is the most important parameter for DBSCAN. Min samples is the number of minimum data points in the neighborhood in order for a data point to be considered as a core data point. This number includes the data point itself. All data points in the neighborhood of the core data points belong to the same cluster. The data points that are not core data points and do not have a core data point in the neighborhood are considered outliers. The label -1 in the prediction results represents outliers. To learn more about anomaly detection, please check out my previous tutorials on one-class SVM for anomaly detection, isolation forest for anomaly detection, and time series anomaly detection using Prophet and Python. DBSCAN does not take a predefined number of clusters, and it identifies the number of clusters based on the density distribution of the dataset. We can see that DBSCAN was able to identify 2 clusters, but was not able to separate the 2 types of flowers that are similar to each other because they are not well separated. DBSCAN pros include: it works on datasets of any shape. It identifies anomalies automatically. DBSCAN cons include: it does not work well for identifying the clusters that are not well separated. Different clusters in the dataset need to have similar densities, otherwise, the DBSCAN does not perform well. In step 8, we will use 2 popular algorithms, PCA and t-SNE, to reduce the dimensionality of the dataset for visualization. There are 4 features in the dataset: we need to convert the features from a four-dimensional space to a two-dimensional space. The output from PCA and t-SNE are saved in the data frame as columns. After dimensionality reduction, in step 9, we will visualize the clustering results of each model and compare them with the ground truth. Note that in the real-world project, the ground truth is not available for clustering models most of the time. The comparison is for illustrating the differences in algorithms only. Before visualization, we need to align the labels of the model outputs. Since the labels are randomly generated, they do not represent the same flower type in different models, so we need to rename the labels so the same label across different models represents the same flowers. For example, we can see that the k-means predicted label 1 corresponds to the true label 0. The k-means predicted label 0 corresponds to the true label 1. And the k-means predicted label 2 corresponds to the true label 2. So the labels are renamed to be consistent with the true label. This process is implemented to the outputs of hierarchical model, GMM, and DBSCAN as well. After relabeling the model predictions, let's visualize the data using PCA first. In the visualization, there are 5 charts. The first chart is the ground truth. The second chart is the k-means prediction. The third chart is the hierarchical model prediction. The fourth chart is the GMM prediction, and the fifth chart is the DBSCAN prediction. We can see that most of the models are able to accurately predict label 0, because it is well separated from other data points. But GMM did the best job separating label 1 and label 2. DBSCAN identified 2 clusters and 2 data points as outliers. t-SNE shows similar results with more condensed cluster visualization. In step 10, we will talk about how to utilize the clustering model predictions in a business environment. One of the most common use cases for clustering models is customer segmentation. In this example, we will talk about customer segmentation using the clustering model results. Let's imagine each flower is a customer and the 4 features are customer age, number of children in a household, tenure with the brand, and distance to the nearest store. We can take the 3 steps below to do customer segmentation. The first step is to do customer profiling for each cluster. The second step is to understand the persona of each cluster based on the profiling results. The third step is to create personalized strategies for different customer segments. From the visualization, we can see that 2 out of the 4 features are the features that differentiate the 3 clusters. So we can create personas around the 2 features and create personalized marketing strategies. Now we have learned how to build different clustering models. You may wonder which model to use for your specific project. I created a diagram to illustrate how to choose clustering model algorithms based on cluster shapes and density. Please cite this tutorial when using the diagram. If the clusters in the dataset are in ellipsoidal shape and with different densities, we can use GMM or hierarchical model. Any of the 4 clustering model algorithms work well with the dataset with ellipsoidal shaped clusters and similar density. For the non-ellipsoidal shaped clusters, we can only choose from DBSCAN and hierarchical model, and DBSCAN model does not work well for the clusters with different densities. Hierarchical clustering model is the most flexible, and it can be used for datasets with any shape and density. In addition to data shape and density, if there is a need to generate new data points for clusters, we need to use GMM because GMM is a generative model. If you have made it this far, you probably find the information in this tutorial helpful. Please click the like button and subscribe to the channel to get notified when I publish new videos like this. To learn more about the clustering model, please click the YouTube playlist on the screen now. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video.